Welcome to LifePoint Church. Whether you're joining us from your living room with your family, at work, or on the road, welcome to our online service. My name is Keith Redonia, and I serve as Director of Information Technology here at LifePoint. If this is your first time joining us, we ask that you fill out our Connect card online at lplakeland.com/connectcard, or by scanning our QR code right here. Our Connect card allows us to get to know you and your family better and how we can best serve you. If you've previously filled out a Connect card, we ask that you check in online so that we can know you're here. You can check in online at lplakeland.com/check-in or by scanning this QR code. We encourage you to engage in our online community through our Facebook page and our website. Welcome to LifePoint. Welcome home.
Church. Ooh, that came on fast. I was telling the band this week I have to come up with something besides, "Good morning, LifePoint Church. Thank you for joining us today. Will you please stand?" But I have nothing new for you guys. So, "Good morning, LifePoint Church. Thank you for joining us today. Will you please stand as we worship our Lord and Savior?"
These are the days of Elijah, declaring the word of the Lord. And these are the days of your servant Moses, righteousness being restored. Though these are days of great trials, famine and darkness and sore, still we are the voice in the desert crying, "Prepare ye the way." Of Ezekiel, the dry bones becoming as flesh. These are the days of your servant David, rebuilding a temple of praise. These are the days of the harvest, the fields are as white in the world, and we are the laborers in your vineyard, declaring the word of the Lord. Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun. Have the trumpet call, lift your voice. It's a year of jubilee. At a Zion's hill, salvation comes.
There's no God like Jehovah. 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 Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun. Have the trumpet call, lift your voice. It's a year of jubilee. At a Zion's hill, salvation comes. Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun.
Good morning and welcome to LifePoint. If you would take a seat for a moment. All right, so we're going to go over our morning announcements real quick. We have a We have a, there we go, Fall Festival informational meeting this afternoon, directly after service in the Fellowship Hall. We have put the date on the calendar as October, or Sunday, October 30th. And Owen is going to be leading that for us. So if you are interested in helping with that at all, and we need lots of help, please stay around for just a short meeting afterwards. And then we have another informational meeting about the ladies' retreat, which is October 6th through the 8th. That's going to be held in the Fellowship Hall as well, right after service. So I believe Owen's going to go first, and then Amanda's going to fill all the details in for that one. And we have game night this week, this Friday. We're already at the end of August. Wow. At the Kenny's home on Friday from 6 to 8 for all of our youth. And if you caught the flyer last week, I put the wrong address on it. You would think I would know where my brother and sister-in-law live, but apparently I don't. So this week's flyer in the bulletin has the correct address. Do not show up to 104 Heritage Park. I don't know if it's a real address. Well, good, because if not, they would show up to somebody's house. Oh, it's the entrance. Yeah, don't go to that house. They won't know what you're doing. So, and of course, we have our worship night on September 11th, where we will be praising the Lord for everything he has done for us and remembering the tragic events of 9/11 as well. And then, starting that same week, Wednesday, September 14th, we will launch our midweek family service right here in the sanctuary. We will start with dinner in the sanctuary, and then at 5:30, and then at 6:30, we'll send the kids their way, the youth their way, and the adults will hang out here for a special message as well. Dinner is in the flyer. Dinner will be build your own subs. We'll have fruits and veggies, and of course, dessert as well that week. Oh, too far, let's see. There we go. LifePoint's Got Talent. The sign-up is now live online. So if you're interested in sharing your talents with us, please sign up online. That will be on September 25th. And with that, we have announcements available online at lplakeland.com on the app, as well as the two display boards in the fellowship hall and in the hallway. And with that, we'll continue worship, if you would stand.
Above all kings, this is
His unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross, you lay down your life, that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. And worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. The Lord bless you and keep you, make His face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn His face toward you and give. The Lord bless you and keep you, make His face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn His face toward you and give. Oh,
Morning. I don't know about you, but I'm excited about our September 14th kickoff of our Wednesday together. Please take advantage of that. And Phil, we're wearing matching shirts. What is up with that? Plan to be there. Go ahead and make your decision that you're going to be here and be a part of that. Another chance to be together, another chance to worship, another chance to hear from God's word. It's all good. So plan to be there. I also wanted to endorse and encourage you to sign up for the ladies' retreat, just the ladies. Patty Headley is going to be teaching for that weekend, and she has been preparing for a long time, right? And she has some great things to share, and it's just also just a wonderful chance for our ladies to connect and to grow in their relationships with each other. So I encourage you to do that. Sign up for that. I also want to encourage you to be faithful in your giving. We have some things that we really want to do, and those things cost money. And so we need your faithfulness. Many of the upgrades and things that you've seen recently have been donated, so we haven't had to spend money on those things. But some things we need. We are redoing the fellowship hall. As you may have seen, it's in progress or in process. We had rented a machine to get up all the glue that's there. We plan to paint that floor. Owen almost took his toe off with that first machine, but we need to rent a bigger machine to get the glue up so we can finish that project. We have been donated paint to paint the outside of the building, so we look forward to that, and if you have paint machines or whatever they are, we look forward to you donating and helping us with those things. And by the way, that room is going to be used, is being used for our youth as well as other things, but our youth is growing, probably quadrupled attendance in our youth in the last month. Yeah. And I look forward to that ministry really taking off and us reaching many young people for the Lord. Let's review a little bit. We're in the book of Jonah. We studied that last week, the first part. In case you weren't here, we started off in verse 1, which says, "The word of the Lord came to Jonah, son of Amittai, get up, go to the great city of Nineveh and preach against it, because their evil has come up before me." A little background I shared about Nineveh, it helps to set the story. Nineveh was a very evil city. The capital of the Assyrian Empire, they had mastered the art of torture and impalement and flaying and beheading, amputations of limbs, blinding, burning people alive. And so when God said to Jonah, go and preach to them, I want to save them, he wasn't on board. God said, go. Jonah said, no. He got in a boat, sailing the opposite direction, 2,500 miles away to a place called Tarshish. God sent a big storm on the boat that Jonah was on, and so big that the storm was about to break up the boat. So the captain goes and approaches Jonah and says, call to your God. Maybe this God will consider us and we won't perish. But Jonah, as we learned last week, was a rebellious prophet. He was not on good terms with God, apparently, the God that he claimed to worship. So the storm rages on. The sailors come in and they ask Jonah, what's up? And he says, well, I've got to admit, it's my fault. I'm running from God. And so he suggested that they throw him overboard and everything would be okay. The sailors were not on board with that. They didn't want to do that. So they began to throw everything off, all the cargo, the invaluable cargo that they were throwing into the sea. And then they tried to row back to shore. Nothing was working. And so at the end, they said, we have no choice. And so we're sorry, Jonah. But they took him and they threw him over. And the very last verse of Jonah says that the Lord appointed great fish to swallow Jonah. And Jonah was in the belly of the fish for 3 days and three nights. The main thrust of last week's message was that there's a little bit of Jonah in all of us. What do I mean by that? Well, just as the word of the Lord came to Jonah with instructions, it comes to us. God's word comes to us with instructions. And like Jonah, we have the choice to obey or to disobey. It's a choice that we have. And like Jonah, unfortunately, we sometimes run from God and his instructions in the same way. But we share something else with Jonah, and this is a good thing, and that is that we're loved by God. Jonah was loved by God, and so are we. And because we're loved by God, he pursues us. So we pick up the story from last week at the end of the chapter of 1. The Lord has appointed a great fish to swallow him. And this is a little bit going ahead of the story to save him. Jonah chapter 2 is the prayer of Jonah. And it's a beautiful Hebrew prayer. The first thing to notice is that it is expressed in the past tense, which suggests that the author, more than likely Jonah himself, is recounting what he prayed, looking back at the moment when he was inside the fish and even before. This is Jonah's memory of what he prayed while he was in the fish. He was not in the fish with a flashlight and pen and a piece of paper going, wow, it's really hard to write in here. What we have here is Jonah looking back and recording in insight, his hindsight, about the lessons that he learned in all of this. And he wrote a very poetic and beautiful rendition of what he had prayed. And it begins in chapter 2, verse 1 says, Jonah prayed to the Lord his God from the belly of the fish. Not insignificantly, Jonah is praying. We're going to see the content of prayer. That is important, but it's important to note that he's praying. We see that for the first time. Jonah is going to cry out to God. And here's the big idea for today, and the main theme of this message is this. God answers his children. He answers his children's cries of distress. God answers his children's cries of distress. At least briefly, Jonah was conscious in the fish long enough to realize that God had saved him from drowning in the sea. And during that period of consciousness, Jonah prays. And it seems that a plain reading of the text tells us that Jonah started his prayer. He began to cry out to God as soon as he hit the water. Maybe even before he hit the water, given the fact that most Jews of that day could not swim. So all the way through, at least through verse 5, they were reflections of his emotions before the fish arrived. In Jonah chapter 2, verse 2 says, "And I called to the Lord in my distress, and he answered me. I cried out for help from deep inside Sheol. You heard my voice." So at least briefly, Jonah was conscious. He was conscious enough to know that God had saved him from drowning in the sea. Again, keep in mind that when Jonah refers to the distress of the past, he means the time he spent in the water, not the time that he spent in the fish. The water is the threat of death, of drowning. The fish is the refuge of salvation. All right? The cry of distress is in the water. The voice of confidence and thanks is present in the fish. He says in that verse, "I called to the Lord in my distress, and he answered me." Pause and think about that for just a moment. I called on the Lord and he answered me. Can you even begin to grasp what that means? That we have the ability to call on the God of the universe, the creator and sustainer, the one who hung the stars and made the skies and the heavens and the earth and the galaxies. That God we can call on in our distress, and he answers us. Amazing. Remember, Jonah called on him very soon after. He had said, "Forget you, God. I'm not interested in your instructions." And yet still, in mercy, God answered him. Don't let that amazing truth pass you by. And we call on God and he'll answer. It's amazing to me that people, and I am included, will say, you know, things, we may not say this out loud, but we're thinking, things are so bad, We've tried everything else. It's so bad, all we can do is pray. Think about how insulting that must be to the heart of God. All we can do now is pray. Why do we hesitate? Why do we wait until it's the last resort to pray when the Word has told us that we can, God has given us the right to go boldly into the throne of God and seek help in our distress? We've been given that right to be in the presence of God and find help. In the second part of that verse, it says, I cried out for help from Sheol. You heard my voice. This word, Sheol, it can mean grave. It is translated places as the realm of the dead. In the Old Testament, the most common way of describing Sheol is the house of death. It's the realm of the dead. It's where all the dead go. The King James Version translates it the belly of hell. And Sheol is a place where there is no escape. Human beings on their own cannot escape. Only something unexpected and from the outside entering can break down the walls of Sheol. In other words, he's saying, from the point where I was farthest from God, from the place where I was most miserable and helpless and desperate and afraid and hurting, from Sheol, I called on God. Now that message speaks to me. It's going to speak to you, some of you, because right now in your life, you're experiencing what you might call Sheol. The pits. Jonah says, from the depths of that place, from Sheol, I called on God and he answered me. When I had no place to turn, I turned to God in the deepest, darkest place of my life. When I needed him the most and I deserved it the least, he was there for me. Amazing. God answers his children's cries of distress. And he does it, amazingly, in spite of our guilt. Jonah was not on his way to Nineveh when he went overboard. He was running from God. He was guilty of disobedience. That's why he was in the water. And many times we are in trouble in our lives and experience Sheol precisely for the same reason. Disobedience. And some of you may be wondering, from where you are in your life, is there any hope? Will God have mercy on me? Hear my cry of distress. And I say, take heart, and take heart from Jonah, because we see that God does hear us when we're in that place, even when it's the fruit of our guilt. We are guilty, and that's why we're there. Even then, God answers us. So if your obedience is the cause of your distress, God calls on us to repent and seek him. God answers his children's cries of distress. And he does it in spite of the fact that he is in the process of judging us. Verse 3 says, when you threw me into the depths, into the heart of the seas, and the current overcame me, all the breakers and your billows swept over me. When you threw me into the depths, Lord. Now, according to chapter 1 and verse 15, it was the ship's crew that picked him up and threw him into the sea. But Jonah knows. Jonah understands that it was all God. It was God who threw him into the sea. It was Jonah's disobedience that caused it. So we could say that God was angry and God was judging Jonah and his disobedience. And he's causing discipline and correction in his life. So even when God is judging us and correcting us, God never punishes us just for the sake of punishment. Involved in that punishment is always redemption. Redemption for us. So he answers his children, yes, even when he is disciplining them. And you see it in verse 4. And I said, I have been banished from your sight, yet I will look once more toward your holy temple. Lord, I know that you've banished me from your sight, but even then, I am going to look to you. I'm going to look to your holy temple. God answers his children when they cry from distress, and he even does it in impossible circumstances. God answers us and delivers us from impossible circumstances. Verses 5 and 6 describe the extremity of Jonah's plight. Verse 5, the water engulfed me up to my neck. The watery depths overcame me. Seaweed was wrapped around my head. I sank to the foundations of the mountains. The earth's gates shut behind me forever. Then you raised up my life from the pit, Lord my God. He said the water was up to my neck. Now, it would be a terrible thing to fall off of a boat in the middle of the ocean and be left behind. Why don't crews? Left behind, even if the sea was calm. But how much worse to be thrown into a sea that is raging. A raging storm with 20 or 30 foot waves, and you're being pulled under. And as you struggle, get up for air, and you hit some seaweed. That doesn't help. And it wraps around your head, around your neck. It's a terrifying scene. And God allowed Jonah's circumstances to become impossible before he delivered him. I don't know why it is, but it seems like in my life, and you may see this and experience this as well, that distresses and troubles and difficulties in our lives become in bunches. Have you noticed that? Have you said recently, if it's not one thing, it's another? That's the way life is. Sometimes our troubles don't get spaced out. They all hit us at once. The circumstances in our lives develop to the point where we can't see any way out. But then we need to remember Jonah's predicament. That's the message of that verse, is that it was impossible. It was the worst place to be. And it seemed an impossible situation. But it wasn't, because there is no such thing with God. With God, all things are possible. And he answers us and he delivers us from impossible situations. And doesn't it seem like he often does it just in the nick of time? Just in the nick of time, God delivers us. Verse 7 says, as my life was fading away, I remembered the Lord. My prayer came to you, to your holy temple. I was losing my life. My life was fading away. He might have been saying, I was losing consciousness. My life was fading away. I remembered the Lord. So just before he blacked out, he's praying. In fact, he probably did black out and regain consciousness in the fish. God often answers our prayers. Have you noticed? In the 11th hour. Doesn't it seem that way? But Jonah gives us courage to be unrelenting in our prayer. Even then, even when things seem the worst, God answers his children. But God always has a purpose for distress in our life. And in this case, and I think in every case, God does it. He answers us, delivers us, saves us, rescues us in order to do something in us. And I believe that it's to win us back. He saves us to win our loyalty and thanksgiving. God answers our cries of distress for a reason. Notice Jonah's change. He's a different man now. Now he's speaking as a prophet in verse 8. He says, those who cherish worthless idols abandon their faithful love. Other translations say it this way. Those who worship false gods turn their back on God's mercies. Or those who cling to worthless idols forfeit the grace that could be theirs. What is forfeited? What is being lost when we cling to worthless idols in our lives? The word at the end of that verse in Hebrew is hesed. And the word means loving kindness, or literally it means the pursuing love of God. We're forfeiting that. We're forfeiting the pursuing love of God when we cling to idols. Those who cherish worthless idols or cling to worthless idols or cling to the stupid things of this world that don't matter, they are unable to receive hesed or the grace of God. Those who cling to idols, he says, they forfeit the grace of God. Now, if you're thinking with me, you're thinking, that's a bad trade. Why would I cling to something that can't save me? Why would I cling to something that can't give me fulfillment, that can't give me joy? It's a bad trade. And some of you today are clinging to worthless idols. And when we do that, we forfeit the grace that could be ours. So the answer to Jonah's prayer has produced the proper effect. He's saying, why would anyone forsake the Lord to keep idols? God taught Jonah that if you leave the Lord, you leave mercy. Then Jonah seems to offer some advice. And he's a man who we want to listen to because he's experienced something amazing. Basically, he's going to say, don't do what I did. In verse 9, he says, but as for me, I will sacrifice to you with a voice of thanksgiving. I will fulfill what I vowed. Salvation belongs to the Lord. God has filled Jonah's mouth with thanksgiving by his salvation. And that's one of the reasons God answers our prayers, to produce gratitude. When we pray and God answers us, it produces in us gratitude. And that's one of his purposes. And ultimately, it generates glory for himself. God answers us for reasons. He wins back the loyalty that we should have for him. And it fills us with thanksgiving. And then he says this, I will fulfill what I have vowed. I will, Lord, I will now fulfill what I said I would do. Probably what he's thinking of is, God, if you tell me to speak, I will speak. If you tell me to go, I will go, whatever it is. I will make good. It brings a question to me. Have I made promises to God? Have I made commitments to God that are unfulfilled? At some point in Jonah's life, he had surrendered to God's will. He was fulfilling his promises to the Lord. As far as we can tell from Scripture, he is mentioned in other places. But he broke those promises. But now he says, I'm going to fulfill what I have vowed. And then he closes with, salvation belongs to the Lord. In other words, it's all him. I couldn't contribute anything to this. Nothing. Salvation belongs to the Lord. And then verse 10, this section concludes, then the Lord commanded the fish, and it vomited Jonah onto dry land. It's disgusting. But it's a powerful image, and it drives home a point and a thought that we should never forget. Think of Jonah laying on the beach in a pool of fish vomit, and he could say this, whether you're on top of the world or whether you are in the depths of hell, the depths of Sheol, when you call on the Lord, he will answer you. He will answer you. I think the story of Jonah, the life of Jonah, is representative in many ways of the life of every person. Jonah's life was not stagnant. It was not fixed. It was not motionless. Like Jonah's life and like our lives, has movement. There's progression in our lives. Our lives go through stages. And at one point in Jonah's life, he was a prophet. And from what we can tell, doing God's will, that was the stage he was in his life. Prophet in Israel, being a prophet, saying what God wanted him to do and say. And then the next stage in his life is God came to him. And God came to him with a word. All right? Next stage, he's on his way to Joppa. And then he's on his way to Tarshish. Then he's on a ship. Then he's in a storm. And then he's in water. He's drowning. And then he's inside of a fish. Then he's in a pool of vomit on the beach. All stages in his life. And in each stage, in every stage of his life, God was working. And in each stage of our lives, no matter where we are in it, God is working in our lives. We can't see it sometimes. We can't tell. But God is working in our lives. Think about this. When Jonah was walking around Israel, just being a prophet, he was God's child, and God knew him through and through. He knew his thoughts. He knew his desires. He knew his strengths. He knew his weaknesses. And knowing all of that, the word of the Lord came to him. So this word was no mistake. There was purpose in the word. And beyond the purposes of what God wanted to do in Nineveh, the word that Jonah received was purposed to accomplish something in Jonah. It saw something in Jonah that needed to be addressed. There was a purpose in that word that came to him. But how, listen, how this was going to be accomplished in Jonah was up to Jonah. It was up to him how God's purpose was going to be accomplished. Now, just as God knew Jonah through and through, he knew his heart, he knew his desires and strengths and weaknesses, God knows us. God knows us through and through. God knows what our strengths are and our weaknesses. God knows what we desire. God knows what we think. God knows if we have idols. God knows if we're committed. God knows if we are loyal to him. He knows all of that. He knows us through and through. And so, when his word comes to us, it's coming to us with a purpose. Never without a purpose. The word comes to us in a purposeful way to accomplish something in us that God wants to address. But it's up to us how that's going to be accomplished. Jonah could have said, oh, you want me to go to Nineveh? I'm gone. I'm there. But he didn't. But God stayed with him through every stage of that journey to accomplish in Nineveh what he wanted to accomplish and to accomplish in Jonah what he wanted to accomplish. Is it? God loves us. God loves you. And he wants to accomplish things in you and in me. That's love. But we bring upon ourselves distress when we don't respond to the word of the Lord in the way that he wants us to. So my encouragement to us is to hear the word of the Lord as it comes to you. And when it comes, whatever it may be, if it's go, if it's give, if it's stop, if it's go, whatever it is, say yes. Yes, Lord. You want me to give? I'll give. You want me to go? I'll go. You want me to take this thing in my life and get rid of it? I'll do it. Because acting upon the love of God is the smartest thing we can do. And I pray that we will do that. The word of the Lord has come to you recently, some way. It may have been here. It may have been in your private devotions. It might have been listening to something on the radio, the word of the Lord being proclaimed. You have heard the word of the Lord. Or maybe you're just walking down the street and God, through his spirit, speaks and says, you need to forgive. You need to stop your attitude. You need to repent. You need to put me first in your life. You need to be loyal to me. Whatever it may be, the word of the Lord comes to us. And we have the opportunity to respond to that word. We have the freedom to do that. God's given us that. I pray we make good choices when we hear his word. Would you pray with me? Lord, thank you so much for Jonah. Lord, thank you for putting him through what you did so that he could learn. And thank you for the story that we can hear so that we can learn and we can grow. God, remind us this morning that when we cry out to you in our distress, you hear us. Lord, help us not hesitate to pray. Help us to not hesitate and wait to come to you. Give us that eagerness to come boldly into your presence. And Lord, give us the power that we need to obey you, to obey the good and perfect word that comes to us. Help us to respond to your love positively. We are in great need, Lord, of your spirit in us. Help us, Lord. I pray that this morning, as you have spoken to each and every one of us in individual ways, we would respond to you. Thank you for the miracle that it is that you even speak. You speak to us, and we have the ability to communicate with you. We thank you for that.
I want to know.
In 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 7, Paul writes, "Each of you must make up your own mind about how much to give. But don't feel sorry that you must give, and don't feel you're being forced to give. God loves people who love to give. At this time, we'll partake in giving back to the local church through tithes and offerings. If this is your first time joining us, please do not feel obligated to give. This service is our gift to you. To give to LifePoint Online, you can do so by going to lplakeland.com/give or by scanning this QR code. You can also give by text. Text the keyword GIVE to 863-777-GIVE, and you'll receive an immediate reply with a link to give directly from your phone.
Now we're going to transition into a baptismal here this morning. I'm honored to see one of our LifePoint students here take this step and publicly go public with his faith, I should say. So I think they're getting ready still. So we're just going to kind of hang tight for a few minutes, and we'll be right with you.
This water is warm. It's hot. Take your time.
Ow.
I'm going to lift him up, don't worry. This is Jaden. Everybody get your picture? This is Jaden Velez. And he's been around here for a little while. Been watching him grow up. We were just talking back here, and I asked him who had shared tell him how to be saved. And he said his Papa Jay, his grandfather, Jay. And I said, "You're very blessed to have him in your life." And I don't know what he called, what do you call it, Miss Debbie? Nana and Brandy and all the rest of the family in his life to support him. And he's 11 years old, and it's what a blessing to see someone come to the Lord at a young age with their life in front of them, with all the opportunities that God is going to give Jaden to serve him and to grow and to give his life to the Lord. And I'm just honored to be a part of his life. We as a church family, we're a family. We're a church family. And Jaden is a part of our family. And so I encourage you to be an encouragement to him. Love on him. Let him know that he's valuable and important here, because he is. And I'm grateful that, Jaden, that you've given your heart to the Lord. You have given your heart to Jesus, and you have decided to commit your life to him, yes? And is it your desire to serve the Lord and follow him for the rest of your life? Good. In that case, it's my honor to baptize Jaden Velez in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Buried like him in death, raised to walk through new life.
Sing for all that you've done for me.
is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave.
Sunday. We hope to see you guys next week.